Hello, anatomy colleagues, and welcome to Station 27, where we really get to talk about some of the specific structures of the coxal bones, or the hip bones, the sacrum, as well as the coccyx. So kind of finishing with the most inferior of the bones in this axial skeleton region. So, we are looking at the pelvic girdle in a similar view to what we saw in the previous station. So just kind of get our bearings. Here is the sacrum, here is the coccyx, and then you are looking at the two coxal bones right here. So they are the dominant structures. And as you hopefully recall, the coxal bones are divided into three main parts. That were separate parts during development, but will eventually fuse where you don't really see the three parts anymore. But we still describe them based on where they were located. So the ilium is going to be the more superior portion. It's also usually the largest portion of the coxal bone. Then you have the ischium, which is going to be the more posterior-inferior portion. And so we'll see a better view of the ischium in another image. So you don't see it quite as much as you will in, say, a posterior view or a lateral view. And then the pubis are going to be your smallest portions. These are going to be more anteriorly placed. And recall that those two pubic bones are going to articulate here at the pubic symphysis, and these very edges of the bones right here are going to be the symphyseal surfaces of the pubis or pubic bones. Another structure we want you to see when you're looking at the ilium is going to be the iliac crests, and these are going to be the superiormost portions or crests of bone. And these are the ones that I keep telling you, if you put your hands on your hips, you are feeling your iliac crests. And so these are important attachment points. You are going to have abdominal wall muscles attaching here, as well as some other back muscles. And latissimus dorsi, one of those superficial back muscles, will also have part of its more proximal attachments on the iliac crest. One other thing I want you to note here is this large foramen that you'll have on each side. These are actually the largest foramina of the body. These are the obturator foramen. So you'll have one on each side. These are going to be kind of formed by the pubis bones and the ischial bones, pubic and ischial bones. And right here in the middle will be these large obturator foramina that hopefully you recall from our discussion in the lecture videos are completely occluded or completely filled in by obturator membrane during life. So it can have muscles actually attaching on that obturator membrane. Now looking at a lateral view, so really we can only see the right coxal bone very well here. You can see the sacrum back in this region. A few, just kind of get our bearings in terms of those different parts of the bone. So here is the ilium. Here is the pubic bones. And here is a better view of the ischium. And so you can, the ischium and the pubis kind of meet right here, as well as in the acetabulum. But the ischium is going to be this more posterior inferior bone here. So again, just a review of a few things we saw on that previous slide. Here is going to be your iliac crest, your obturator foramen. We can only see one here. You can see a little bit of one poking through right there. So that'll be the obturator foramen. And I want you to note a few other things that we can see a bit better on this lateral view. Right here, kind of between the ischium and the ilium, there's going to be the greater sciatic notch. And if you kind of add in the ligaments that would be running here, you would have one ligament from the sacrum to the ischial spine right here. That would be the sacrospinus. And then you would have from the sacrum to the ischial tuberosity over here. And see that we're actually forming, if you had those ligaments in place, a greater sciatic foramen. But this part of the bone right here is referred to as the greater sciatic notch. My computer is just really excited to talk about this, and so it's getting a little overheated, so I apologize if you hear that in the background. So this posterior portion, this part that's really kind of built up right here, is going to be the ischial tuberosity. Sometimes you hear this referred to as your sit bones, because when you're sitting down, it's almost like you're sitting on the ischial tuberosity with, of course, ligaments and skin and some other stuff in that region. But it's in that general position there. So that ischial tuberosity is of the ischium, and it's this really kind of thickened, rugose portion right here. And then you can't look at a lateral view without observing the very large, very prominent acetabulum that is going to be the socket portion of the ball and socket hip joint. So that's where the head of the femur will articulate. It's actually going to be composed of all three of these bones, and that fusion actually occurred within the acetabulum at some point during development and kind of growth. And so that ilium, the pubis, and the ischium would actually kind of fuse right in this region. But you can see that this area is mostly pretty smooth. You would have articular cartilage that is going to sit here during life, because that's what you're going to have in any synovial joint, right? Okay, let's look at the sacrum, and we're actually looking at a posterior view of the sacrum, because really you can see a lot more of the structures that I want you to identify. So real quickly, let's just make sure we remember that this is a posterior view. And the reason I know we're looking at a posterior view is because you can see these little remnants of the spinous process. It's a bit more complex looking when we're looking at the posterior view. And another thing that's really something that helps me identify I'm looking at a posterior view is this right here, which is called the sacral hiatus. And the sacral hiatus is just a naturally occurring missing, basically, or missing of a fusion of the lamina of S5 and sometimes S4. So it's not pathological. Most individuals will not have that fusion here. So it looks like just this opening that is giving you a clearer view into the sacral canal. And the sacral canal is basically just a continuation of the vertebral canal into the sacrum. It would be deep to this region here, and it would continue right into here. So that would all be part of that sacral canal. And this particular portion right here would be the sacral hiatus. Also quite prominent throughout, you have usually four pairs of sacral foramina. We're looking specifically at the posterior sacral foramina. If you flip this over and we're looking at the anterior side, you would see the anterior sacral foramina, but they are going to be continuous throughout. And this will allow for the ventral primary rami of the sacral spinal nerves to exit to head to their target tissues. And last but not least, we will have the coccyx. And the coccyx is generally four fused vertebrae that are very rudimentary. The first coccygeal vertebrae is typically the most distinct, but is certainly not quite as distinct as even what you have in the sacrum, and definitely not in terms of the movable vertebrae. And oftentimes, this first coccygeal vertebrae is not completely fused to those smaller coccygeal vertebrae that are the most inferior. So they get smaller and smaller. They really aren't going to play that big of a role in terms of weight bearing, but you will have ligaments as well as muscles attaching to the coccyx. All right, excellent. So that is the specifics of those structures that you see within the pelvic girdle. We have one more stop, one more station, and that's going to be the pelvic musculature. So I will see you at station 28. Thank you for your time and attention here.